Queens of Europe.
Queen Anne Boleyn of England. Anne Boleyn, the most famous mistress in history, who won Henry VIII's heart and the crown away from Catherine of Aragon. He split the Church of England from Rome for her, but later grew tired of his second queen and had her beheaded. Her legacy was being the mother to one of the greatest queens in history, Elizabeth I. Anne's early life is somewhat of a mystery. Her birthday is unknown, and even the year of her birth is debated. Most historians believe she was born in 1501, but some argue that she entered the world as late as 1507. Her sister Mary was definitely older, but it is unclear if Anne or her brother George came next. The Boleyn family was well respected among the aristocracy. They were distant descendants of King Edward I, and more recently a Lord Mayor of London. The children were born at the Boleyn family estate, Blickling in Norfolk, but raised much closer to London at Hever Castle in Kent. Anne's parents were Thomas Boleyn, Earl of Wiltshire, and Lady Elizabeth Howard, also from a prominent family. Her father was a talented diplomat and was sent to the Holy Roman Empire as an ambassador. There, he so impressed the emperor's daughter, Margaret of Austria, that she offered his 12-year-old daughter Anne an honored position as lady-in-waiting. Anne traveled to the Netherlands to attend Margaret, who ruled there as regent. Up to this point, Anne's education had been typical of an English aristocratic girl of her generation. She was instructed by her mother in history, reading, writing, and arithmetic. She learned domestic skills including dancing, embroidery, manners, household management, music, and singing. Once Anne arrived in Austria, her education was greatly expanded under Duchess Margaret's tutelage. Margaret was an incredibly intelligent, powerful, and progressive woman for her time. She introduced young Anne to early Enlightenment philosophy, feminist ideas, and most significantly, Protestant Reformation. Margaret was impressed with her charming, bright, and mature new ward, whom she called Le Petit Boleyn. She wrote to Anne's father, thanking him for doing her the favor of sending a young lady so presentable and so pleasant, considering her youthful age. After 18 months with Margaret, Anne was given an even more prestigious position as maid of honor to King Henry VIII's sister, Mary, who was about to wed King Louis XII of France. But Mary's marriage only lasted 3 months before King Louis died of gout and Mary returned to England. Anne stayed in France to serve the next queen, 15-year-old Claude. Anne's older sister Mary briefly joined her at the French court. Fair Mary was considered the more beautiful of the sisters, while Anne was the more astute. It was rumored that Mary conducted affairs with several men, including King Francois I. Thomas Boleyn sent Mary back to England to be wed, where she commenced an affair with King Henry VIII, and gave birth to 2 children who might have been his. Meanwhile, Anne remained at the sophisticated French court for 7 years, where she gained knowledge of art, dance, fashion, music, poetry, and the flirtatious art of courtly love. Rumors later plagued Anne that she had learned a variety of unmentionable sexual tricks in France, which she used to ensnare King Henry VIII. But in reality, she lived a fairly sheltered life in Queen Claude's inner circle. She spent most of her time cloistered away caring for the queen during her 7 back-to-back pregnancies and wouldn't have had much time for love affairs. Anne did, however, become friends with King Francois' sister, Marguerite de Navarre, an outspoken humanist, evangelical reformer, and remarkably for a woman of the time, an author. The princess encouraged Anne in her growing convictions, supporting Protestant church reform. At 21, Anne was called back to England for an arranged marriage to an Irish cousin, James Butler. The union was intended to settle a dispute over which side of the Boleyn family would inherit the Earldom of Ormond and dampen a potential Irish civil war. Her father put a halt to the matrimonial negotiations as it became clear that he could get a much better match for his alluring second daughter. He secured her a coveted position as a lady-in-waiting to Queen Catherine of Aragon. Anne made her debut at the court of Henry VIII while dancing in a pageant. She played the part of Perseverance in the elaborately choreographed production. In her white satin gown embroidered with gold thread, she caught the eye of many men at court. Anne had dark hair and eyes, olive skin, and a slender figure. Contemporary reports disagree on her beauty, but are unanimous that her true attraction lie in her dazzling wit, humor, and magnetism. With exceptional skill in dancing, singing, lute playing, perfect French, deftness in games of cards and chess, and a love of hunting, horseback riding, and a good joke, Anne was a joy to be around and quickly became the social star of court. Her French style was the envy of all the ladies, and she popularized wearing the French hood, which revealed a shocking amount of hair. Many young men vied for her affection, and she became secretly engaged to Henry Percy, son of the Earl of Northumberland. A marriage to Percy would have been quite a coup for Anne and her family. Northumberland was a more powerful seat than theirs, and becoming a countess would have afforded Anne a good deal of power and influence. Plus, she and Henry actually fancied each other, a real rarity among noble marriages of the time. But his father objected, and the match was called off. Anne soon caught the eye of an even bigger player, King Henry himself. Unlike other ladies, including her own sister, who had gone quickly to Henry's bed, Anne resisted the king's advances and refused to become his mistress. At one point, she escaped court and returned home to avoid the amorous monarch. There he sent her several letters begging her to return to him. He signed off one missive, "Wishing myself especially of an evening in my sweetheart's arms, whose pretty duckies, 16th century slang for breasts, I trust shortly to kiss." Historians hotly debate Anne's motivations. Was she playing a coquettish game, putting Henry off in the hopes of enticing him to leave his wife and make her queen? Or was it more of a medieval Me Too situation? Was she protecting herself from the king's boorish advances in the hopes of preserving her reputation for a more realistic marriage to a respectable nobleman? Either way, it was pretty dangerous to say no to King Henry VIII, and eventually Anne agreed to marry him. At this point, Henry had been married to Queen Catherine of Aragon for 17 years. Catherine had become pregnant several times during their marriage, but had lost her children to miscarriage and infant mortality. She and Henry had but one living child, a daughter, Princess Mary. The only previous time a woman had inherited the throne of England was Empress Matilda in the 12th century, and she had been ousted by civil war. Henry's own father, Henry VII, had become king only after winning the War of the Roses, a dispute over the crown between cousins. Henry VIII became obsessed with the desire for a male heir to follow him and secure the Tudor dynasty. As Catherine, and Henry for that matter, entered middle age, it became clear that the couple would never have a son together. When the teenage Catherine first arrived from Spain, it was as the bride of Henry's older brother Arthur, who died a few months into the marriage. Henry fixated over a biblical passage from Leviticus, which stated that it was a sin to marry your brother's widow, and that such a couple would be childless. Henry was sure that he could swap Catherine for Anne in a matter of months. He asked the Pope for an annulment and asked his wife to step aside and move to a convent so that he could remarry. But the king was shocked and enraged when both refused his request. Catherine maintained that her marriage to Prince Arthur had never been consummated and was therefore invalid. And the Pope was currently under siege by Catherine's nephew, Emperor Charles V of Spain, so had little choice but to come down on Catherine's side. Thus ensued 7 years of legal battles with Catherine and unconsummated courtship with Anne. Anne, too, was frustrated. She was approaching 30, middle-aged by 16th century standards, and wanted to be married before her childbearing days were behind her. During this time, the gravitational pull at court shifted, putting Anne in the center and Queen Catherine on the outskirts. Henry created his intended Marquess of Pembroke in her own right and gave her significant power and influence. Anne was devoted to the idea of Protestant reform of the church and was known to have supported many evangelicals and the publication of the Bible in English. She encouraged the king to pursue reform of the English church as a means to secure a divorce. Henry decided to split with Rome and declare himself head of the new Church of England. This way, he could grant himself a divorce. He required his subjects to swear an oath, proclaiming him as the absolute religious authority in the land, and recognizing Anne as the rightful queen. Those who refused were sentenced to death. Devout Catholics saw Anne as the enemy and accused her of using witchcraft to ensnare the king. Years after her death, some tried to discredit Anne's Protestant daughter, Queen Elizabeth I, with claims that Anne had six fingers, a sure sign of a witch. In November 1532, after a triumphant trip to France to secure an alliance with Anne's old friend, King Francois I, and with a divorce now all but inevitable, Anne finally went to bed with the king. The couple were married in a secret ceremony, which technically made the king a bigamist, but couldn't wait as Anne was already pregnant. The exact date of this wedding is unknown, and it may have been backdated to secure the legitimacy of Anne's child. The divorce was finalized in May, and in June, visibly pregnant, Anne was crowned Queen of England in a magnificent ceremony at Westminster Abbey. St. Edward's crown, which had previously only been worn by monarchs, was placed on her head. This may have been done to symbolically also crown her unborn child, which both she and Henry were confident would be the next king of England. In September, Anne gave birth to a healthy child. But to Henry's consternation, he had another daughter, Elizabeth. Despite their disappointment, the couple were happy and very much in love at the time, secure in the hopes that other children of the male persuasion would follow. As was royal tradition, baby Elizabeth was sent to live away from court with her own household to care for her. But her mother Anne loved her very much, visited her often, and planned to play a large role in her education as a Protestant princess. As queen, Anne indulged her love of fashion and spent lavishly on gowns, jewels, headdresses, ostrich feather fans, and renovating various palaces to her tastes. But she also gave generously to the poor and continued to support the education of reformist scholars. She bore the brunt of the blame and hatred for her husband's tyrannical government and was also disliked for her own inability to quickly produce a male heir. She was known by her enemies as the King's Whore. Anne suffered a miscarriage during the Christmas festivities of 1534, and Henry's eye began to wander. Catherine of Aragon died at the age of 50. When Henry and Anne learned the news, they dressed in yellow from head to foot. It is unclear if this was crude gloating over the former queen's demise or done in her honor, as yellow is a traditional color of mourning in Spain. Anne sent overtures of friendship and reconciliation to Catherine's daughter Mary, but was rebuffed as the princess hated the mistress who had taken her mother's place, and even suspected Anne of having had Catherine poisoned, though this is very unlikely. Catherine's death was hardly good news for Anne's place as queen. With his well-connected royal wife out of the picture, if the king wanted, he could easily dispose of his disappointing English wife and remarry. He had already begun an affair with one of Anne's ladies-in-waiting, Jane Seymour. Henry gave Jane a locket, and when Queen Anne saw it, she ripped it from Jane's neck so violently that her hands bled. Increasing strife in the royal marriage, partly due to Anne's refusal to ignore the king's philandering, caused Henry to resent his wife. Luckily, Anne soon found herself pregnant again and clung to the hope that the birth of a son would salvage her marriage and position. During a jousting match, King Henry was struck and fell from his horse. He was unconscious for 2 hours and everyone feared the worst. He recovered but suffered a leg wound that plagued him for the rest of his life, ending his athleticism and allowing him to pile on weight. Historians hypothesize he actually sustained a serious concussion and brain damage that would explain his hair-trigger temper from then on, though he certainly showed signs of psychopathy and borderline personality disorder well before the injury. The shock of the accident also caused Anne to miscarry her child. This sad event was the nail in her coffin. Anne's enemies at court, particularly Lord Chamberlain Thomas Cromwell, gathered or created evidence against her. Musician Mark Smeaton confessed under torture that he had slept with the Queen, and named four other men in his testimony, whom he accused of having adulterous affairs with Anne. They included the King's best friend, Henry Norris, as well as Anne's own brother, George Boleyn. Cromwell brought his case to the King, who was only too happy to believe it. After 2.5 years of marriage, Anne was arrested and brought to the Tower of London. Henry declared that he had been bewitched into marrying Anne and quickly moved Jane Seymour into Anne's apartments. Queen Anne was tried in court for adultery, incest, and treason, all of which she was almost certainly guiltless of. She pled her innocence and begged her husband for mercy, but Henry had decided that he was done with the woman he had once moved heaven and earth to marry. While in the Tower, waiting to die, Anne spent her final days coming to terms with her mortality. She composed the poem, "O Death, Rock Me Asleep," and was stoic to the end. The five men accused alongside Anne, including her own beloved brother, George, were beheaded on Tower Hill in sight of her room. 2 days later, she was brought to Tower Hill for her own execution. The punishment for her crimes was burning at the stake, but Henry, ever generous, commuted her sentence to beheading and hired an expert swordsman from France to do the job far more quickly and less painfully than a clumsy axe. On the scaffold, Anne gave a moving speech to the crowd and knelt before the swordsman with dignity. The fallen queen's body was placed in an arrow box. She was buried in an unmarked grave in the Tower of London's chapel. Anne's remains were later identified when the chapel was renovated in 1876. She did not have six fingers. Her final resting place is now identified on the marble floor. Within days of Anne's murder, Henry married wife number three, Jane Seymour. She gave him his longed-for male heir, the future King Edward VI. But despite Anne's tragic end, she got the last laugh. For it was not Henry's son who became a famously spectacular sovereign, but Anne's daughter, Elizabeth. In next week's video, we'll explore the dark childhood and fabulous reign of one of England's greatest monarchs, Queen Elizabeth I. If you enjoyed this video, please like, subscribe, comment your thoughts, and check out my other royal history videos. If you really want to help, please consider supporting me on Patreon. A link is in the description. Thank you for watching.